So I'd like to introduce Adrienne Keene for our first paper.
Hi everyone, I am Adrienne Keene. I am a citizen of the Cherokee Nation, and I'm currently an assistant professor of American Studies and Ethnic Studies at Brown University. And I am also the author of the blog Native Appropriations. So what I've been tasked with talking about today is to try and cram an overview of cultural appropriation and fashion in 20 minutes. So I hope that 20 minutes can stretch into 3 hours. I'm sure that's fine, right? So there's a lot going on here. And I also want to be a bit didactic in my presentation. I want to kind of give us a shared language to talk about cultural appropriation, about why it's wrong, about where these power issues come into play, and talk a lot about settler colonialism, because that's kind of what I do. And after I submitted my PowerPoint really late last night, I took the opportunity to lurk on my other fellow panelists' presentations, and I think there is some nice overlap, and we kind of lead into each other, so there will be a few things that I'll touch on very briefly that it looks like other folks are going to talk about as well. Apologies for folks who are very steeped in this conversation if any of this seems kind of introductory, but I think it's important to have that review as well. So I always start my presentations with this slide. So if anyone's seen me present before, this is always the slide that I start with. And what this is what happens when you Google image search Native American. And so this to me is really important for a number of reasons, because it really goes and shows what place we're operating from as a society, what people think about when they think of Native Americans. And you can see from here, there's several things that really jump out. The first is that these are predominantly historic photographs or paintings. These are things all set in the past or as like fantasy kind of things, not real. Most of these images are images of men, which largely erases the presence of Native women. And then most of them come from the sort of plains Hollywood stereotype sort of look, with the big war bonnet, which we've seen a lot of today, with the buckskin, with the feathers. And so this is what most people are bringing to the conversation about Native Americans. When they're thinking of drawing upon Native American, quote unquote, aesthetics in their work, they're thinking of these stereotypes, which collapse the vast, vast diversity of Indian country with over 567 federally recognized tribes and hundreds more state recognized and non-federally recognized tribes. That gets erased in this. And that becomes a big problem, which we'll see in these themes that come up over and over again in Native appropriation in fashion. And so to give a little background of who I am and why I am somewhat qualified to talk about this topic, I write a blog called Native Appropriations. I've been writing this blog for now 7 years, which in internet years is like 200 years. Like, nothing on the internet has been going for 7 years. It's a very long time. So I kind of have seen this arc of what's been going on in everywhere from sort of fast fashion to more high-end fashion, of these trends of using Native culture as a market, to market for fashion. I started the blog in my first year of grad school. This is what it used to look like, and this was my very first post. I wrote about a trip to Urban Outfitters. So the blog really started out of this desire to kind of question and problematize what was going on in the fashion world. So in the past 7 years, it's grown. It now looks like this. And then I also am very active on Twitter. So the process for me of thinking through these issues is a process of trying to condense really complex issues of cultural sovereignty and settler colonialism and racism down into 140 characters and try and convince other people along with me. But it's a challenge that I've taken on, and I really greatly enjoy it because I've been able to see kind of incremental change through these mediums. So while I have been blogging about this, the kind of global conversation about cultural appropriation has really grown as well. And I want to be clear that this is not a new phenomenon. I mean, we have seen images in the last presentation and from other folks, like, this is something that's been going on since first contact between Native peoples and settlers. But in the last 5 years on the internet, this has been a conversation that now has a name, and that name is cultural appropriation. So this is the Google trend of the last, this is about 7 years, of people searching for the term cultural appropriation. And I bet if we zoomed in on several of these kind of peaks, we could actually identify the event that was going on during that time that caused people to start to Google this phenomenon. So what is cultural appropriation? I think the last presentation, I love the Wikipedia quotes. I actually use them in my classes when I teach about cultural appropriation. But this quotation comes from Lenore Keeshing Tobias, who is a First Nations writer. And it came from a conference that they pulled together of Native writers in the 90s. So this conversation was happening back then among Native folks. But the most basic definition from her is taking from a culture that is not one's own, intellectual property, cultural expressions and artifacts, history and ways of knowledge. Now, this on the surface is not necessarily problematic. What this definition doesn't bring into it is these really deep issues of power that are at play in this process of cultural appropriation. So, this slide kind of, I want to talk through a little bit the harms of cultural appropriation. So what is at stake when we're talking about this? And I think it's something that some of my other panelists will dig into as well. But on cultural appropriation, there's kind of these two sides that we're talking about of harms. There's the economic harms to a community, and then there are the moral and cultural side of things. The economic ones are things people tend to have a little bit easier time wrapping their head around because we live in a capitalistic society where money is what we talk about. So I'm not going to go into these ideas of intellectual property and trademark and copyright because Susan will talk about that. But it's these ideas that these designs, these cultural markers belong to a community. They are owned by communities, but our society is not set up to view cultural ownership in that way. We're very much something that thinks about ownership to individuals and not collective. So that's really hard when you're thinking about a design that might not have a single owner. It might not have a person you can point to and say, this is their design. Though a lot of these, which we will see, do. But the bottom line on the economic side of things is that the appropriating group is benefiting while the people that the designs or cultural markers come from is not. So these large multinational companies are making tons and tons of money off the backs of Native people who have created these designs, maintained these designs despite 500 years of settler colonialism, and they are not benefiting from the sale of those designs. But on the moral and cultural side, which is one that people have a little bit harder time wrapping their head around, a Native scholar named Rebecca Sosi talks about cultural appropriation interferes with a community's ability to define and establish its own identity. So if I'm standing up here as a Cherokee woman and I'm telling you that these are the things that make me who I am, these are the things that make me a Cherokee woman, and then all of a sudden anyone can go and buy those things at Urban Outfitters or Target or see them walking down the runway, it starts to eat away at my ability to draw those distinctions and to really talk about what makes me who I am. And a lot of these are sacred aspects of culture. So especially this headdress that we're seeing everywhere, that's something that's used in ceremonial contexts. It's something that has to be earned. Each of those feathers is indicative of the respect and the trust of the community in the wearer of that headdress. And then they're ripped out of that context and used however they see fit, folks see fit. And that takes away from those the spiritual power and connection of those objects that should be allowed to stay in those spiritual spaces. And then, as I talked about with that image from Google, these contribute to stereotyping. So all of a sudden, these images that we see everywhere are what real Indians look like, are what real Indian culture is, when the reality is it's so much more complex than that, so much more diverse than that. But because these are the ubiquitous images we see, that gets associated with it. And the last piece of this is the idea of cultural survival, cultural sovereignty. So in indigenous communities, we are sovereign nations. We have inherent rights of sovereignty, which means that we have the power to have jurisdiction and control over our lands, over our resources, over our education, our healthcare, whatever it is. And we should also, under that, have jurisdiction and control over our culture. So that is a very important part of being a sovereign nation and having those inherent rights of sovereignty. But the biggest issue of this is that we're talking about issues of power here. So this is never an equal exchange that's happening on this like equal playing field where we're all borrowing from each other. This is a situation where we have a colonizer taking from the colonized, and you can't ever separate it from that situation of power. So that's when you have situations of people saying, well, like, I'm Irish and I don't get offended when people wear kilts. There's a difference of power structures there. So again, this is situated in the context of settler colonialism, which I'm going to talk a little bit more about. So settler colonialism, we are all standing on indigenous land today. Everywhere you walk in the United States is indigenous land. And I use this GIF to demonstrate the speed with which the vast amounts of land were lost in this process of settler colonization. So quickly, settler colonialism versus other types of colonialism means that rather than in other forms of colonialism where you're extracting from a community to send back to a nation state in another place, settler colonialism is destroying in order to replace. So settlers came over to the US, to Canada, to New Zealand, to Australia, and sought to create a new nation state on top of what was already there and push out the indigenous residents of that land. So that's the, when I'm talking about settler colonialism, that's what I mean. The settlers are still here. There's no post-colonial in this context. So in order to justify this dramatic loss of land and life, indigenous people had to be painted as culturally inferior, as savage, as less than human. And that continues on with our cultures in this process of cultural appropriation. So our cultures are painted as less than human, as savage, as pre-civilization, and so therefore aren't given the same weight and reverence that other cultures are given. And this is continued through this process of forced assimilation through the government boarding school system. So not only when the process of trying to eradicate Native people physically through wars and displacement didn't work, then we moved on to cultural genocide. And Native youth as young as 3 were sent to these schools where they were not allowed to speak their language, they were not allowed to wear their traditional clothing, their hair was cut. And all of a sudden, these are the designs that are suddenly in Urban Outfitters and are seen as cool and everybody wants to wear. And so in this picture of Tom Torlino at the bottom, you can see him wearing his traditional blanket and his jewelry, and he was not explicitly not allowed to wear that. And now all of a sudden, we are not allowed to have control over the ways that people are using that outside of our community context. Settler colonialism and colonization in general is about extraction. It's about extracting people, indigenous peoples from the land. So this is a painting of the Trail of Tears, that actual physical movement of Native peoples off the lands. And then it's about extracting the resources from those lands. So that's when we see all of the mining and extractive industries that happen on indigenous lands. And then it's also about extracting the culture from those communities. So if we think about settler colonialism as a process of extraction, that's what we're seeing with cultural appropriation. So now I have 10,000 examples for you. And I'm going to move through them really quickly and not really dwell on them in the interest of time, but I have a lot. So ASOS, go Native with Aztec and Navajo prints. They invented chewing gum and chocolate, but surely the Aztec's greatest achievement was inspiring these fresh prints. Hello Kitty wearing a headdress. Carly Kloss, which we talked about in the last presentation, but I do think the piece that we didn't point out is, so we've got the Plains headdress, we've got the Southwestern style jewelry, not sure what community the leopard print bikini comes from, or the fringe high heels, but you know, just a mishmash of cultures there. J. Crew with a teepee in the window. This is Nicole Ritchie's line, House of Harlow. These are baby moccasins that retailed for over $300, which you can buy some really great ones from a Native person for about that much. Tommy Hilfiger. Echo had a weekend warrior line. This was a brand called Nicholas K. And it's not just the headdress here. It was the marketing of this line. It was called an Apache shamanistic journey. And the whole copy for the entire line was about like finding feathered fans in the hills and shamans wrapped in textures. And it was a mess. Ralph Lauren with his winter catalog of cultural appropriation. Using pictures from that assimilation time period that I showed of the boarding schools where we were being forced to wear Western clothing to sell his clothing. Paul Frank's Dream Catching Powwow, which Jessica Metcalf and I were very involved in, that actually resulted in a collaboration between Paul Frank and Native designers. This was Chanel. Karl Lagerfeld putting some headdresses down the runway in 2014. Tribe Called Coach Collection in 2015. And D Squared's extremely racist and extraordinarily offensive D Squaw line in 2015. And I could keep going. This was literally, I was just off the top of my head remembering things of what I could show. And I did want to, when we're talking about this idea of ownership, I thought that this is a prime example to think about the ways that designers separate these designs from the actual communities and individuals that they come from. Jeremy Scott for Adidas made this totem pole outfit. So if you Google image search totem pole, the totem pole, I don't know if I have a, do I have a, oh, I thought I had maybe a pointer, but right on the bottom there is a very famous totem pole that's in Stanley Park in British Columbia, and he literally took it and just put it on there. But that's a totem pole that has an artist, that has a history, that has a meaning, that has a community it comes from. It's not just kind of, as Jessica Austin talks about, our designs are in the free bin for everyone to take. And it's not, that's not the case. This is something that comes from a place and has a power associated with it. It's not just there for consumption by outsiders. And so then we have Urban Outfitters. And I'm not going to talk about the entire case, but briefly, this is an interesting way, I think Susan might touch on it too, about how a community can use the power of trademark to kind of fight back against this cultural appropriation. Navajo, in 2011, I saw that Urban Outfitters had 24 products named Navajo on their site. I let my friends in Navajo Nation know, and they were called like Navajo socks, Navajo flask, Navajo hipster panty is what those other ones were called. Navajo Nation sent a cease and desist to Urban Outfitters saying that we have trademarks over the term Navajo in conjunction with textiles and I think it's like 70 or a bunch of different trademarks there. And then they took the step after no response to go ahead and sue Urban Outfitters. And that was in 2012. And the case just was settled out of court this year. And the agreement was that Urban Outfitters will now collaborate with Navajo designers to market real Navajo jewelry through Urban Outfitters, which seems like an interesting win. But then we have this trend of squash blossom jewelry showing up places, which is a problem. And this showed up at Anthropology recently. And Anthropology is the same company as Urban Outfitters. So they just settled this lawsuit and are already selling fake Navajo jewelry, turned around, did it immediately. They're not called Navajo necklaces, but still, that's directly squash blossom. So it'll be interesting to see how this collaboration plays out. And then we had KTZ that we talked about a little bit before. Bethany Yellowtail, Native designer, did a great show here the other night. That is her family beadwork that showed up on KTZ's runway. Charlene Holybear, who is an amazing Native artist, found this comparison also from the runway. And then later, after they got in trouble for this, we saw this direct copying of a shaman's coat from an Inuit community. And that was one that has a specific context that they totally just stole away. And this was KTZ's response. Over the last 20 years, KTZ has always been inspired by and paid homage to indigenous cultures and tribes around the world. It's part of KTZ's DNA to celebrate multiculturalism as a form of art and to encourage appreciation for traditions, ethnicity, and religions' diversity, which is totally like word vomit right there. That means nothing. Because especially, this is the granddaughter of the man who was in that original coat. And she says, How dare you use this garment design that was envisioned by my great-grandfather? It's his design, his vision, it's so meaningful to him. I want to know how they got it, how they obtained the exact replica, and I want to know why they didn't ask our family. Did they think that we do not exist? Okay, so this is a blank slide on purpose. For you to take a deep breath, that was like a lot of information, but I want you to realize that this wasn't even close to being exhaustive. Like this was not, you should be overwhelmed, you should be tired, and you should hopefully be a little bit outraged. These are cultural markers that have been taken without permission and used to make money for non-Native companies. And so what have we learned in the last 5 years? So in the last 5 to 7 years, we have learned that the internet can be a tool for pushing back on these instances. In most of these situations, we got an apology. In some of them, we got product pulled from shelves. And in a couple, we got collaborations with Native designers and communities. But we've also learned that this is a problem that doesn't seem to show signs of slowing, and that these companies don't actually face much of a backlash when they engage in these harmful practices. But I hope the design students in this room, the folks who are engaged in these ideas, can see that these aesthetics of Native design aren't new, aren't necessarily fashion forward, and that it's time to really push beyond these stereotypes and learn how to let Native designers represent themselves in our communities. Because we know the boundaries of what's sacred, of what's off limits, and we know how to think creatively in these modern contexts about our cultures. And I wanted to add that it is perfectly fine for non-Natives to wear Native design. I think that's a question I get all the time. But I want folks to buy it from Native designers. I want you to know the story. I want you to know who made it. I want you to know where it comes from. And I want you to be supporting those communities. So then if someone comes up to you and asks you about it, you know the story, and you can tell them, and you can go from there. So because you only get to use the ignorance excuse once, so I have just educated you, you no longer get to say you don't know. These are all the things that I hear all the time. But Native culture is so beautiful, I just want to honor it. But I use sustainable materials and cruelty-free feathers. But free expression. But my great-grandma was Cherokee. But you're wearing jeans and speaking English. That's cultural appropriation. But it's been hundreds of years, you should maybe get over it. But I'm Irish and we were oppressed and I don't care about people wearing kilts. But it's art, inspiration comes from everywhere, but it's just fashion. So all of these are not valid excuses, and I'm putting it up here to kind of preempt the Q&A, actually. I've heard all this. I've been doing it for hundreds of years in internet years. So at this point, I heard it all, and I'm tired, and so please don't think that any of this is a valid excuse. So as my final slide, I want to put up, this is kind of an adaptation of a phrase that they use a lot in Australian Indigenous communities. They use nothing about us without us. And so I want you to think about, why do you want our culture but not us? And why are our designs and cultural markers used to enhance white culture while white cultural artifacts are protected and policed? The bottom line is this: there should be no representations of us without us. You want to draw on Indigenous cultures for your line, you need to involve Indigenous artists and designers. There's no alternative answer. And so we have a panel later about the joys and challenges of collaborations, and I want to leave you with this idea. Native communities are rooted in relationships. It's about relationships to land, to culture, to community, to kin. And Indigenous relationships carry with them responsibility and an expectation of reciprocity. And so if the fashion industry wants to engage with Native designs, they need to enter it from a lens of creating an Indigenous relationship, one that carries with it that responsibility, carries with it that reciprocity. It's more than just paying for a design or a checkbox that you had a Native advisor. It really needs to lead towards the goal of Indigenous liberation. So, wado, thank you. Yeah.